Hi, I'm Ed Bacon, the rector of All Saints Church, Pasadena. Whoever you are and wherever you find yourself on the journey of faith, I hope that you'll find something here that speaks to you. Welcome.
Maestro, Eckhart said that if the only prayer you ever pray is thank you, that's enough. So the only thing I need to do is thank a lot of people. First, I want to thank you all for being here. It's wonderful to fill this room with your energy, with your curiosity, with your desire to make the world a better place. I want to thank Anina Minotto and her daughter Ariana Gad for organizing all of our work as volunteers. Thank you very much. I want to thank our custodial staff and our sound staff who are in this booth and all around, and also Keith Holman, who has been video streaming live and making a video record of this event. Thank you all for all of your work. To Christina Hanschel, who's overseen all the administrative details and made this look like it is a well-oiled machine and has hidden from you all of the sausage making in this process. Thank you very much, Christina. If perchance you got in here and we have not received your name and contact information, we would very much like to have that. Probably by virtue of your registration, we have it, but just in case, if you give it to Anina, she'll make sure that you're on our mailing list. We have a very diverse group of people to whom we send a message every Thursday about what's coming up on Sunday and whenever there are special political actions that we want to organize around. It is a way for us to call you into political action also. So please be a part, at least, of our mailing list. Finally, I want to thank Marcus Borg for extending himself to come to All Saints Church to teach us, to inspire us, to make us laugh, and to call us into deeper faith and more revolutionary transformation. It is my pleasure to bring back to this podium Marcus Borg.
Well, good evening. Very nice to be back with you again. And I want to begin tonight by acknowledging that I've had a very rich time here over the last 2 days. I want to thank Ed for inviting me and for making space in his schedule for us to have, 4 hours of private time together. That's probably worth about $20,000, I would think. So anyway, thank you very much, Ed. And once again, great to be here. And I want to, as I did last night, start off with something light tonight. We have heavy material to consider. This is a country western song that I first heard in Western North Carolina last September. I'm not going to sing it to you, but I'm going to read it to you. It's by a country western singer whom I had not heard of before. First name is Hayes. Second name is Carl, C-A-R-L-L. But if you like it, you can find it on the web simply by putting in the title of the song, which is, "She Left Me for Jesus." A song of pain. So, here we go. We've been dating since high school. We never once left this town. We used to go out on the weekends, and we'd drink till we drowned. But now, she's acting funny, and I don't understand. I think that she's found her some other man. Chorus. She left me for Jesus, and that just ain't fair. She says that he's perfect. How could I compare? She says I should find him, and I'll know peace at last. If I ever find Jesus, I'm kicking his ass. It's not over with, folks. She showed me a picture. All I could do was stare at that freak in his sandals with his long, pretty hair. They must think that I'm stupid or I don't have a clue. I'll bet he's a commie or even worse, a Jew. Chorus again, which I won't read to you. Next verse. She's given up whiskey and taken up wine. While she prays for his troubles, she's forgot about mine. I'm a-gonna get even. I can't handle the shame. Why, last time we made love, she even called out his name. And the final chorus. She left me for Jesus, and that just ain't fair. She says that he's perfect. How could I compare? She says I should find him, and I'll know peace at last. If I ever find Jesus, I'm kicking his ass. And if you do Google this song, you'll find not only the lyrics and a number of different versions, but a video of him performing this in a bar. And it's clear that the people in the bar know this one. They start applauding the moment they hear the opening chord, you know. Okay. So, I'm going to ask you just one question tonight. How many of you have read the book that I wrote with Dom Crossan, The Last Week? Okay, that's not too bad. 20% maybe. The rest of you are in for a treat, of course. But the reason I ask that question is that much of what I'm going to say tonight is also in that book. And I want to acknowledge that one of the perils of publishing is once something is out there in print, is it okay to go around talking about it? I've often thought Jesus was fortunate to have been executed before the Gospels were written. You know, can you imagine if those manuscripts were already out there and he came into a town and told them the parable of the prodigal son? They would nod politely and they would say, we know that one. Do you have anything new? let me now make the transition into this evening's talk with a brief prayer, this time a prayer from the Celtic Christian tradition, from a Celtic Christian named Alcuin, A-L-C-U-I-N, from around the year 800. And so we go back in time some 1,200 years to these words from Alcuin. Give us, O Lord, we pray, firm faith, unwavering hope, a passion for justice. Pour into our hearts the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and spiritual strength, the spirit of knowledge and true compassion, and the spirit of wonder in all your works. Light eternal, shine in our hearts. Power eternal, deliver us from evil. Wisdom eternal, scatter the darkness of our ignorance. Might eternal, have mercy on us. Grant that we may ever seek your face with all our heart and soul and strength. And in your infinite compassion, bring us at last to the fullness of your presence, where we shall behold your glory and live your promised joys. In your name, O Christ, our body and our blood, our life and our nourishment. Amen. So I turn to my talk of the evening. The Passion of Jesus, focusing tonight on Holy Week, Good Friday, and Easter. To say the obvious, we are on the threshold of Holy Week. This coming Sunday is Palm Sunday, and then Holy Week begins to unfold. And when I think of my memories of Holy Week growing up, Palm Sunday was always quite celebratory, of course. And then we didn't think much about Holy Week on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. But then, of course, Thursday evening was the service where we heard the great commandment to love one another and talked about the foot washing, though as Lutherans, of course, we didn't actually wash feet. And then the somberness of Good Friday, which I understood to be Jesus dying on the cross to pay for our sins. And then, of course, Easter. And I must admit, I had only a very vague understanding of Easter as a child. I knew it had something to do with life after death, with Jesus opening up the way to heaven for us, and it provided a happy ending to the solemnness of Holy Week. And I now appreciate that Easter is, of course, the most important festival of the Christian year. But in my childhood, it was probably number three. Christmas was the most special day of the year. 4th of July was second. And Easter, yeah, I knew it was special, but it wasn't really clear to me why. And so I want to talk about what Holy Week has come to mean to me now and what it might mean for us. And I begin with the brief prologue that is on the handout, namely two meanings of the phrase, the Passion of Jesus. And I introduced these briefly last night. The first meaning is what he was passionate about. As when we ask of somebody, what's your passion in life? What are you passionate about? And the answer to that question, as I suggested last night, is that Jesus' passion was God. The centrality and reality of God for him was at the center of his life. And his passion was also God's passion, namely the kingdom of God as the passion of Jesus and the passion of God. And again, that's what I spoke about last night. Then there's the narrower meaning of the word or the phrase, the passion of Jesus, namely as his suffering and death. And of course, this is probably the more conventional meaning. Think of Mel Gibson's movie of 9 years ago now, The Passion of the Christ. What that movie focused on, of course, was basically the last 12 or 18 hours of Jesus' life from his arrest through his torture and trial and suffering on the cross. And my central claim tonight, or of last night and tonight put together, is that it was Jesus' passion in the broad sense of the word, his passion for God and the kingdom of God, that led to his passion in the more precise sense of the word, his death. So, I begin with Holy Week, leading up to Good Friday and Easter. And this is what I write about, what Dom Crossan and I write about in the book, The Last Week. We follow Mark's story of the last week of Jesus' life. And very strikingly, the Gospel of Mark, which of course is the earliest gospel, gives us a day-by-day account, actually dividing up the days. And so what I'm going to say now is based on the Gospel of Mark, but it's not simply a repetition of Mark. It's about setting Mark in the historical context of the first century. I begin with Sunday, what we call Palm Sunday. That very familiar story of Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a donkey, being cheered, by the way, not by the Jerusalem crowd. When I was growing up, it was typical for pastors to say, "How fickle we are. Sunday morning, we're cheering him riding into Jerusalem, and by Friday, we are screaming, 'Crucify him, crucify him.'" Complete misunderstanding. It's his followers from Galilee who have journeyed with him to Jerusalem who stand there cheering his entry, not the Jerusalem crowd. In any case, the basic outline of the story is familiar to all of us. What is less well known is that there were two processions entering Jerusalem for the season of Passover. There had been for 30 years or so from when the Roman Empire took over direct rule of the southern province of Judea. From the west, a Roman imperial procession entered the city, headed by the governor, Pontius Pilate. Imperial reinforcements, cavalry and foot soldiers alike, brought up from the coast to reinforce the Roman garrison permanently stationed in Jerusalem, because the season of Passover, which recalled ancient Israel's liberation from the Empire of Egypt, was the time of the year when most frequently there were riots, anti-Roman demonstrations, and so forth in the city. And Jesus would have known that because it was the regular practice of the Roman governor. And this makes his entry into the city all the more significant. Mark tells us that Jesus set it up in advance. It was a carefully pre-planned political demonstration. And think of the contrast between somebody riding into Jerusalem from the east on a donkey, which was a woman's animal or a peasant's animal, versus the pomp and panoply and power of empire entering the city from the west. Two processions entering the city. The imperial procession symbolizing the power of empire and domination and control through violence and the threat of violence. The procession of Jesus entering from the east. And not only that, but his mode of entering the city had symbolic significance. The book of Zechariah, in the 9th chapter, speaks of a king of peace, a humble king, who will enter the city riding on a donkey. Now, don't misunderstand that Jesus was trying woodenly to fulfill prophecy. That's not the point at all. The point is there is this symbolism in the prophets of a king of peace entering the city on a donkey. And this king of peace will banish the war horse and the chariot and the battle bow from the land, the weapons of war, and he will speak peace to the nations. Palm Sunday, Jesus enters in the city in a way that proclaims that the kingdom of which he speaks is a kingdom of peace compared to the imperial system of domination and violence. Holy Week begins with a peace demonstration. And my shorthand designation for that, as you can see in the handout, is the anti-imperial entry into the city. Then we get to Monday. Shorthand for what happens on Monday, the Anti-Temple Act. Now, this is the familiar story of Jesus overturning the tables of the money changers in the temple. And when I was growing up, and admittedly had only a childhood imagination and not much historical knowledge, I always imagined that it was like tables set up in the narthex of the church, where people were doing business. And so, of course, the issue is, you don't mix business and church, you know. We were really down on the Catholics because they played bingo in the church, you know. And so it was like, okay, don't mix business and religion, you know. And that's such a trivial understanding of what was going on. The temple had become the native center of the domination system, meaning Rome ruled the Jewish homeland through the local aristocracy. This is how Rome liked to rule all of her provinces, enlist the local aristocracy because they kind of know how to do it. And they'll be loyal to us, of course, if we keep them on. And the local native aristocracy consisted primarily of the high priestly families, the extended families of the high priestly class, and they were the temple authorities. And the temple was also the institution charged with the collection of taxes for the tribute paid to Rome. Rome benefited financially from her empire in many ways, in part through the commercialization of agriculture, and I won't detail that right now, but also by requiring that her provinces each pay a rather large amount of money to Rome a year. This is the tribute. And the temple authorities, as the native rulers, were in charge of collecting the Roman tribute. And so the temple had become the center of an economically exploitative imperial domination system in the Jewish homeland. And when Jesus overturns the tables of the money changers, who were agents of the authorities, it was a protest against the economic role of the temple in the domination system. And the passage from the Old Testament that is quoted in Mark's story makes that crystal clear. The passage goes like this: "My house," and it's a quotation from Isaiah, so "my" doesn't mean my Jesus's house, but God's house. God's house is meant to be a house of prayer. And then the rest of the quotation is from Jeremiah 7:11. "But you," not meaning these low-ranking money changers, but the people in charge of the temple, "you have made it a den of robbers." And it's not about the money changers charging too high a rate of exchange. It's about the role of the temple in the economic exploitation of the peasant class. It's a public prophetic act. I have to be careful not to go on too long about this, but some of you are aware that some of the prophets of the Jewish Bible performed provocative public acts in order to express their message. Isaiah, for example, over a period of 3 years, from time to time, walked naked through the streets of Jerusalem. It's a real no-no in that world. And when people would say, "What are you doing?" his answer was, "The days are coming when you shall be carried away naked as prisoners of war." Ezekiel was the master of street theater. He built a scale model of Jerusalem in a public square in Jerusalem and then laid siege to it with a toy army. And again, the purpose was to get people to say, "What are you doing?" And then the answer would be, "The days are coming because of the injustice of this kingdom when it shall be surrounded by an enemy army and destroyed." It's like the Berrigan brothers in the late 1960s, along with some others, walking into a selective service office in Maryland and pouring duck blood on the selective service files in that office, a public prophetic act of criticism and protest designed to be provocative and attention-getting. That's what Monday is about. And we're told the authorities decide, because of that, that they must take action and decide to kill him. But they don't dare arrest him in public because a lot of the crowd is with him. By the way, at Passover, Jerusalem was crowded with pilgrims from all over the Jewish world. The best estimates of Jerusalem's population in the first century, about 40,000. Estimates of how many people were there for Passover, about 200,000. And the temple was built on a temple platform, a level area with porticos all around, 24 acres in size. And you could get 100,000 or more people in the courts of the temple. And because so many in the crowd were sympathetic to Jesus, the authorities are afraid to take action in front of the crowd because they don't want to cause a major riot. That's Monday. Tuesday. Tuesday is filled with stories of verbal conflicts and debates between representatives of the authorities and Jesus in the temple court area. It's a fascinating series of stories to read through, and you see the utter skillfulness and brilliance of Jesus as a debater. I could linger on this too long, but I'll try to be brief and give you just one or two examples. Starts off with representatives of the authorities coming up to Jesus and saying, "By what authority are you doing these things?" And Jesus says, "I'll tell you what. If you answer one of my questions, I'll answer your question." And they're stupid enough to say, "Okay." And so Jesus says, "The baptism of John, by whose authority was he doing that? Did his baptism come from God, or was it a human invention?" And we're told that the authorities, representatives of the authorities, confer with each other. Now, let's see now. If we say it was from God, then he'll say to us, "Then why didn't you listen to him?" And if we say, "Now, it was just a human idea, well, there are a lot of people in the crowd who really like John, and we don't want to get in trouble." And so they come back and they say, "We don't know." And Jesus says, well, you haven't answered my question. I'm not going to answer your question, okay? And one more story. The famous render unto Caesar story is in this context. And again, we're told representatives of the authorities are trying to trap Jesus with this question. And the question is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? And it's in some ways a great question. If he says, yes, it is, then he'll discredit himself with many in the crowd who are anti-Roman and who resent Roman imperial rule. If he says, no, it's not okay to pay taxes to Caesar, then they would have immediate grounds to arrest him for treason. So what Jesus does is say, do you have a coin? And they produce a coin, must have been a silver denarius because of how the story unfolds. And show it to me. And he looks at it. And a denarius has Caesar's head on it as well as an inscription. And Jesus says, oh, whose image and inscription is this? And of course, they have to say Caesar's. And inscription, everybody witnessing this story or hearing it at the time of Mark's gospel would have known what the inscription on a coin of Caesar says. Amongst other things, it would have said, Caesar, son of God. And so when Jesus says, oh, whose inscription and image is this? And they say, Caesar's. They've discredited themselves already. Not only are they carrying a graven image, observant Jews used imageless coins, and there were imageless coins in circulation in that time. So they've discredited themselves by producing a coin with an image of Caesar on it. And then Jesus says to them, huh, it's Caesar's coin. Give it back to him. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's and give to God what is God's. Now, the terrible thing is that sometimes in the history of Christianity, that's been understood to mean, oh yeah, separation between religion and politics. Obey Caesar in the political realm, obey God in the religious realm. This is one of the texts used in Nazi Germany during World War II to justify Christian obedience to Hitler. And of course, it's what many Americans understand this text to mean. If you know what's going on in that story, what belongs to Caesar and what belongs to God? Everything belongs to God. Not a damn thing belongs to Caesar. Anyway, I want to illustrate the cleverness of Jesus in these verbal confrontation stories. And they occupy Tuesday. Moving more rapidly, Wednesday, it's quite brief in terms of what's said about it. An unnamed woman anoints Jesus for burial. And it's quite moving. And presumably she does so because she's pretty sure there's not going to be much of a corpse left to anoint afterwards. And Judas goes to the authorities to tell them where they can find Jesus when he's not with the crowd, because that's the information they need. Thursday, his final meal and his arrest. Little footnote comment here, a dig at the church. I really resent the fact that Thursday evening of Holy Week services are about love one another as I have loved you and the foot washing. It completely misses what is going on that night. A final meal with his friends, with the language of that meal, anticipating what is going to happen. Bread and wine, body and blood, you get separation of body and blood only in the case of a violent death. And to change Thursday evening into, we should love one another. How insipid. Are you with me, Ed? I know Thursday evening services are already planned, so, okay.
And the universe.
And we could do foot washing some other time. You know, that'd be great. All right. Let me now move to the climax of this story. Good Friday, followed, of course, by Easter. The death of Jesus. And I begin with a negative prologue. Because if we don't clear the ground in advance, we'll miss what this is about. The negative prologue. The death of Jesus is not about substitutionary sacrifice, not about, to say the same thing in slightly different language, substitutionary atonement, even though common Christianity has often thought so. Many of us, as I mentioned Sunday morning, grew up with the message that Jesus paid for our sins by dying in our place, hence the language of substitute, so that we can be forgiven. In shorthand, I call this the payment understanding of Jesus' death. It's really important to know that this notion is not found in the first 1,000 years of Christianity. It's not there. It was first articulated around 1100, 1098 specifically, by Anselm of Canterbury. What it says about the death of Jesus is that it had to happen. It was part of God's plan. The logic is all of us have sinned and therefore owe a debt to God. That debt must be paid or God cannot forgive, because if God forgave sins without payment being made, it would imply that ultimately sin doesn't matter that much to God. And the payment, I mean, the most any of us could do would be to pay for our own sins by dying, because we're all sinners. So if somebody's going to pay for the sins of the world, they have to be perfect, without sin. And Anselm argues, and this is the reason for the incarnation. This is the reason why God became human in Jesus, so that our infinite debt to God could be paid by somebody who is spotless and without sin. Now, I've already said, this actually makes the death of Jesus part of God's plan of salvation. Think about that for a moment. That it was God's will that this immeasurably good, passionate, courageous human being whose passion was God, was actually God's will that he get killed. It lets the authorities completely off the hook. There's a recognition that, of course, they did it, but it was part of the plan of God. It betrays the passion that animated Jesus' life. And think also what it says about God. That God demands that the price be paid or else. I don't need to belabor the point, but God ends up being far worse than any decent human parent. No human parent demands a blood sacrifice when their children have been disobedient to them. You might ground them for a week or something. But I mean, it's terrible history, and it's terrible theology. It really creates the monster God. There's a further reason for being so harsh about this understanding of Jesus' death. There is no precedent, no foundation for the payment understanding of sacrifice in the Bible. In the Old Testament and in the Jerusalem temple, and those are the historical contexts for the New Testament's use of the language of sacrifice, sacrifice is never about payment for sin. Most generally, animal sacrifice was about offering a gift to God. Indeed, that's the root meaning of the word sacrifice in English. It comes from the Latin, to make something holy by offering it up as a gift to God, sacrum facere. And so sacrifice is offering the gift of an animal up to God, and very often involved a meal as well. Part of the animal was completely burned and ascended to God in smoke. The rest of the animal, in effect, was cooked and was eaten by the group or the community offering the sacrifice. So sacrifice also involved a meal with God. There might be some interesting Eucharistic implications there as well. And then very quickly, so I don't go on too long about this, sacrifices had a number of purposes. And my reason for going through this list is simply to make the point that none of the purposes were about payment. There were sacrifices of thanksgiving. You offer up a gift to God out of sheer gratitude for something that's happened. Some were sacrifices of petition. You want something from God. Perhaps a drought has struck the country, or a plague, or enemy armies are invaded, and you are petitioning God for help, for aid, for assistance, and you offer up a sacrifice to God as part of that petition. You could understand it crudely as trying to get God's attention or trying to bribe God, but you don't have to go in that crude direction. You make a gift as part of a petition. There were sacrifices of purification. Some human activities made you impure. Let me use as a simple example childbirth. A woman was impure for 40 days after giving birth. And the impurity was removed on the 40th day, by offering up a sacrifice. If you were from the wealthy class, probably would be a sacrifice of a lamb. If you were from the poor class, it could be the sacrifice of a pigeon or a dove. And it was simply part of the process of purification. It's not about payment. It's not even about sin. There's nothing sinful about giving birth. Okay. And then finally, there were sacrifices of reconciliation. You could call them atonement if you want, in the root meaning of the word atonement, at-one-ment, okay? A way of overcoming a gap that has developed. And so here, a person or the community had a sense of having wronged God. And so as a way of reconciling yourself to God, you make a gift to God and frequently share a meal with God. By the way, this is almost omnipresent in human behavior. If you forget your spouse or partner's birthday, what do? The next day, you hit your forehead. But the really important point is you respond with flowers and taking them out for dinner. It's about gift and meal as a way of reconciling a breach. It's not about payment. Point being, sacrifice is a rich biblical word, but don't let it get associated in your mind with payment for sin. So continuing with Good Friday, what happened historically? It was, of course, an execution. And we all know that. And because it was on a cross, we know that the authority condemning Jesus to death was Roman. In the first century world, a cross was always a Roman cross. And thus, by the way, when Paul says in 1 Corinthians 1, when I was with you, I resolved to preach nothing amongst you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Notice he doesn't say, I resolved to preach nothing amongst you except Jesus Christ and Christ dying for your sins. He specifies the mode of execution. And because, as I just said, in that world a cross was always a Roman cross, Paul is signaling this is an anti-imperial gospel. So, it was a Roman execution. And we should take very seriously that Christianity is the only major religion whose central figure was executed by established authority, by Roman imperial authority in collaboration with high priestly temple authority. And if we ask, why did they execute him? The answer is pretty clear. Because he had become a radical critic of the domination system in the name of the kingdom of God, and he was beginning to attract a following. If he had simply been a radical critic of the system and nobody was listening to him, who cares? You know, they let crazy people alone for the most part. But it's because he was a radical critic who was beginning to attract a following that they took action. In shorthand, he was killed because of his pacification. His passion for the kingdom of God. And here I underline that Rome could have killed him in many ways. You know, sent a big, strong guy into a dungeon prison cell and choked him to death. Or just left him in a dungeon to die of starvation and all the things that could happen in a dungeon. Or, you know, sending out a hit squad to stab him in a dark alley. They crucified him because crucifixion was a very public, painful, and prolonged form of execution that sent a clear warning, this is what happens to those who challenge our authority. And I note in passing, crucifixion was reserved as a form of execution for those who systematically defied Roman authority. It was, if you will, state-sponsored terrorism. Third point about Good Friday, his death as a sacrifice. And I want to come back to this word and use it positively now. Namely, his death was a sacrifice in the sense of giving his life because of his love for others. but not as substitution or payment. Recall the ancient meaning of sacrifice from earlier in this lecture, to make something sacred by offering it up to God. Its etymology from Latin is to make sacred. Did Jesus offer his life up to God? Yeah, but not as payment or as something required by God. Think of sacrifice as dying for others. Dom Crossan, in our book the last week, used the example of a firefighter rushing into a burning house, dashing up to a second floor bedroom where there's a baby, running to a window with the baby and dropping the baby into a safety net below, and then the house collapses on the firefighter and she's killed. A newspaper headline that said, "Firefighter sacrifices life for baby," would be completely accurate. But it's not about payment. It's not about substitution. Think also, as a way of making this point, of the three most famous 20th century Christian martyrs. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, executed by the Third Reich on April 8th, 1945. Martin Luther King, killed by an assassin's bullet on April 4th, 1968. Oscar Romero, shot through the heart while celebrating Mass in a hospital chapel on March 24th, 1980. I mention the dates because all three of these were killed in the season of Lent and early Eastertide. You could speak of all three of these martyrs as sacrificing their lives because of their love for others. Dietrich Bonhoeffer sacrificed his life because of his love for the victims of his own people, and to some extent because of his love for his own people as well. Martin Luther King sacrificed his life because of his passion for his own people, and you could even say his passion for America. Archbishop Oscar Romero, the chief Roman Catholic figure in El Salvador, became the voice of the 90% of the population who were radically impoverished, consistently indicting the ruling class for their exploitation and their violence. He made a gift of his life to God because of his love for others. In this sense, Jesus sacrificed his life, but not because God required it or as payment, but because of his love for the victims of that system. And then finally, death and resurrection and the word sacrifice as central New Testament metaphors for transformation. I talked a little bit about this last night, so I'll be brief right now. Paul's language about being crucified with Christ, dying and rising with Christ, these are metaphors for that radical internal transformation at the center of the Christian life. And this is one of the meanings of Lent, Holy Week, Good Friday, and Easter. We are called to make that journey that leads through death and resurrection, to participate in that journey, because it is the journey that leads to life. And as I also mentioned last night, this is the central meaning of being born again. And then the language of sacrifice. If I were to make a list of what I see as the 10 most important passages in the New Testament, and I don't have such a list, but it might be interesting for you to think about that for yourself. On that list would be a passage from Paul in Romans 12, 1 and 2. The passage begins with the word, therefore. And whenever Paul uses the word, therefore, un in Greek, listen up. Because he's drawing the conclusion to an argument that maybe started 8 verses earlier or 8 chapters earlier. It's like, okay, let me tell you what this all means. And Romans 12, 1 through 2 goes like this. Therefore, present yourselves as living sacrifices. Make of your life a gift to God. And it continues, do not be conformed to this world. This world in Paul and to some extent in the Gospel of John doesn't mean the world of nature. It means the humanly created world of culture. And in particular in Paul's context, it meant the humanly created world of dominant culture. Do not be conformed to the domination systems of this world, but be transformed. And then it continues, through the renewal of your psyches, through the renewal of yourselves at their deepest level. Now I turn to Easter, the resurrection of Jesus. And I think I can do this in less than 10 minutes, okay? I begin with how it has commonly been understood within what I call common Christianity, what most Christians took for granted, shared in common until not so long ago. It intrinsically involves physicality. That something miraculous happened to the corpse of Jesus so that the tomb was really empty. Even some quite sophisticated Christian scholars affirm this. Many of you know the name N.T. Wright. Tom Wright, he's the best-known British New Testament scholar in the world today, maybe the best-known New Testament scholar in the world, not just British. And Tom and I co-authored a book a dozen years or so ago. And we were on Terry Gross. And she, near the end of the interview, asked about Easter. And Tom, one of the two most brilliant people I've ever known, said, if he became convinced that the tomb was not empty, he would resign his ordination as a priest and do something else. My point being, it's not just that a lot of people have kind of taken it for granted that, of course, Easter means that the corpse of Jesus was transformed. Even some very brilliant, sophisticated scholars make that case. My own conviction is that to emphasize that something happened to the corpse of Jesus is a huge distraction. I'm happy to say, believe whatever you want about that, but don't get distracted by that. As if Easter is false if the tomb wasn't empty. Or as if Easter is really about God's ability to transform corpses. Instead, I think the most helpful question is to ask, what did Easter mean for the followers of Jesus? We can leave uncertain what happened, but we can be very certain about what it meant for them. And it meant primarily two things that are intrinsically connected. This is true in the Gospels, in Paul, in the New Testament as a whole. First, Jesus continued to be experienced after his death. I think the evidence is overwhelming that some of the followers of Jesus had experiences of him after his death. Paul certainly did. And of course, his experience was visionary. A lot of good reason to think that other followers of Jesus had visions of Jesus after his death. In 1 Corinthians 15:3 through 8, when Paul provides a list of people to whom the risen Christ appeared, he includes Peter and James, the 12, and 500 of the brothers and sisters at one time. And last of all, as to one untimely born, also to me, because his experience was a vision, and he includes his experience in the list of other people to whom the Christ appeared, he's probably thinking of those as visions too, and he uses that word, that verb, appeared four times in that passage, and that's the word used to speak of a vision most commonly. I think there were non-visionary experiences, a sense of the presence of the same Spirit they had known in and around Jesus during his lifetime, continuing to be known within the community. Visions, by the way, can even involve a sense of touching, tactility. You know, just like our dreams can. And, you know, sometimes people have said to me, "You mean these were only visions?" And I want to say, anybody who's ever had a vision would never say it was just a vision. And secondly, his followers experienced him not simply as a figure of the present, and not just as a ghostly figure from the past, but as divine, as Lord, as one with God, raised to God's right hand. You know, there are some people who have experiences of Elvis. But I don't know anybody who has said, "Elvis is now at the right hand of God." Or, "My Lord and my God." We do call him the King, but that's another matter. Okay. But there is something about the experience of the risen Christ that led, in the words of Thomas in John's Gospel, "My Lord and my God." And together, this sense that Jesus is a figure of the present and not just of the past, and that he is one with God, all of this led to the conviction that God has vindicated Jesus, said yes to Jesus, and therefore no to the powers that killed him. If we don't understand Easter within that framework of God saying yes to Jesus and no to the powers, we in many ways miss the whole point of Holy Week. The powers killed him, but they couldn't stop him. And this leads me to my final point then. Hearing the Easter stories as parables of the resurrection. The model for this is the parables of Jesus. I don't know of any Christian who insists that there really had to be a good Samaritan who behaved that way, or a prodigal son who went into a far country and whose father received him back that way, or these stories aren't true. We all get the point. Parables are about meaning. They are meaning-filled and meaningful stories, and in that sense, truth-filled and truthful stories, independently of whether they happened that way. That's my suggestion for how we most helpfully see the stories of Easter. An illustration, the story of the empty tomb. And I choose this one. There are so many of them. The Emmaus Road story is a magnificent parable of the resurrection. But I'm going to do the empty tomb story because it's the earliest one. And it's the only one in the first gospel, Mark 16, 1 through 8. You all know how the story goes, of course. Three of the women followers of Jesus go to his tomb on what we call Easter morning, expecting to anoint his body. And they get there, and by God, the stone has been rolled away. The tomb is empty. Then an angel appears to them and says, by the way, whenever an angel shows up in a biblical story, listen up. It's the job of the angel to tell you what's going on. The word angel in Greek even means messenger. Okay? So, an angel shows up and says, you are looking for Jesus whom they crucified. And then, why do you seek the living amongst the dead? He's not here. It's how the story goes. Listen to that as parable. You're not going to find Jesus in the land of the dead. Imperial execution and a rich man's tomb couldn't hold him, couldn't stop him. He's out there. He's loose in the world again. He's still recruiting for the kingdom of God. Oh my. Compare that meaning to some kind of vague notion that because God raised Jesus from the dead, we might be raised someday too and get an afterlife. How trivial. So, the difference between believing in the passion of Jesus, believing in his death and resurrection on the one hand, and participating in his passion, participating in his death and resurrection. The difference between believing that this happened and participating in it is a difference great enough that it almost produces two different religions, both using the same language. So, we are called to participate in what we see in Jesus, to participate in his passion for God and the kingdom of God, to participate in death and resurrection. And this is what following Jesus and the season of Lent with its climax and Holy Week, Good Friday and Easter are all about. Thank you.
I think they're ready to leave.
Would you be interested in commenting on the Road to Emmaus story a little bit, and in particular to this quote within it, where the two disciples say, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us, and what that means to us again?" What it sounds similar to what you just already said, but if you could speak to that.
The Emmaus Road story used to be my favorite Easter story. It's still very close. It's only recently that I think the story of the empty tomb has become even more interesting to me. But let me remind you of the Emmaus Road story and what a marvelous example it is of a parabolic story rather than being a literal factual story. Again, you all more or less know how the story goes. It's mid-afternoon on the day we call Easter. Two followers of Jesus are walking from Jerusalem to a village called Emmaus, which according to the story is 7 miles away. As they walk along, they're joined by a third person, whom we know to be the risen Christ, but they experience him as a stranger. And the risen Christ says to them, "What is it that you're talking about?" And they turn to him and they say, "Are you the only person who doesn't know what's been going on in Jerusalem these last few days?" Little bit of humor there, not exactly a thigh slapper, but you know what I mean. And so they tell him what's happened. And then the passage that you read is found. They continue to journey together. Their hearts are strangely warmed as he tells them about the meaning of Scripture and so forth. And of course, this is Luke, the author, writing from the vantage point of maybe 60 years later, maybe 80 years later. There's a growing tendency in scholarship to date Luke Acts in the early 2nd century rather than in the 80s or 90. And so hard to know whether the author of Luke intends us to understand that Jesus was anticipated in prophecies from the Old Testament, or whether it's just his sense that, as I put it Sunday morning, Jesus is the norm of the Bible. Okay. And then, to go back to the story, they get to their stopping place for the night. It's twilight now. And the stranger, whom they still haven't recognized, is about to leave. And they say to him, "Stay with us, for the day is far spent." Or in the words of the King James Version, "Abide with us, fast falls the eventide." Kind of haunting. The night is coming on. Don't leave us. So he agrees to stay. They go into the inn. They sit down at a table. They still haven't recognized him. And then he takes bread. Eucharistic formula coming up. Blesses it, breaks it. And then we're told, in the breaking of the bread, their eyes were opened. And they recognized him. And then you know what happened. He vanishes from their sight. What more could the author of Luke have done to say, "Don't read this literally. Please don't read this literally." But its meanings, you know, the risen Christ journeys with us, whether we know that or not, believe that or not, sometimes in the form of a stranger, but don't literalize it even that much. It's the risen Christ is here. Whether we see that, know that, or not. And sometimes there are those moments when we become aware of that. And then they're gone. And it's also saying, one of the ways we know the risen Christ is in the breaking of the bread. But that doesn't mean it's automatic. You know, like every time you have Eucharist, you know, the risen Christ, you're going to experience the risen Christ. Of course, it doesn't mean that. But there is a sacramental dimension in it. Okay.
Nancy? It's on. It's on. You don't have to turn it off. I know that Jesus didn't speak English.
Right.
But given the translators who had to filter through Aramaic and Greek, etc., how can we be reasonably confident that what we are finding are actual words of Jesus?
Yeah, there are two issues there. One is the issue of translation. And though there are mistranslations and sometimes unfortunate translations, for the most part, translation is not the problem. You know? Now I immediately need to add, translating metaphor and poetry is much more difficult than translating prose. So if you've ever tried to translate a poem from German into English or something, you know. But for the most part, translation is not the problem. So the second comment is this. The Gospels are the product of a developing tradition. Mark, the earliest gospel written 40 years after the life of Jesus. Luke may be the latest, might be as late as 80 years after the life of Jesus. Matthew and John in between. And during those decades, the words of Jesus and the stories of about Jesus, for want of a better verb, developed. Sometimes they were polished. You know, like think of the parables of Jesus. The longest one is the parable of the prodigal son. If you read it at a normal out loud reading voice in English, it takes 3.5 to 4 minutes. I'm sure Jesus told that story 100 times or more. Probably in somewhat different form each time. I don't mean the plot would change or even the characters. But it's like when you tell a long joke. And I'm not saying it was a joke, but I'm just using something we all know about. If you tell a long joke, probably each time you tell it, it's somewhat different. You get the punchline the same all the time. And what the common word for this is gist. You know, if you know the gist of a joke, you can retell it, even if the details are quite different. And so what we have in, let's say, the parables of Jesus is the gist of a story he would have told many times at different lengths, probably. You can easily imagine the prodigal son being spun out into a great 20-minute story. Get into details of that young son's life in that foreign country where he squandered his inheritance, you know? Anyway, on the other hand, a parable like the kingdom of God is like a woman putting leaven in a bushel of grain. Boy, it'd be tedious to string that one out. Anyway, I'm getting kind of silly now. But anyway, so my basic point is that there are earlier layers and later layers of Jesus' material in that developing tradition. And so if what one is concerned about is how much of this goes back to Jesus and how much is the voice of the community in the decades after Easter, the real obstacle to that is not the problem of translation, but that layering of the tradition. And I myself, even though my primary area is historical Jesus scholarship, I'm not one of those who thinks that if it doesn't go back to Jesus, we might as well ignore it. I see the material in the Gospels that I don't think goes back to Jesus as the voice and witness and testimony of the community to what he had become in their thought and experience.
Okay, we're going to take two last questions, and then you answer both and summarize the entire length of the meaning of life. First question.
First of all, I want to thank you so much for me personally, for deconstructing some really important ideas, such as sacrifice. And I would love for you to deconstruct the idea of Jesus as Lord. Growing up for me as a young man, it meant that I couldn't have sex, and I had no will, that I had to sacrifice everything to God's will. And I don't know what would you say it means, Jesus is Lord?
Yep.
And then this question?
Mm-hmm.
I want to thank you for your scholarship.
Okay, an ice cream
cone. There it is. I was quite an uncomfortable Christian until I found yours and Dom's and John Spong's and others' writings, so thank you. But one short question and a little bit deeper question. The short one is that crowd of 200,000 in Jerusalem at Passover. I know the authorities knew who this Nazarene troublemaker was, but how many would you guess of that 200,000 might have known who this man was? And then the second, I know that you make it around the country a lot and you have this talk with many sympathetic ears and even around the world, but I've heard you refer to the other theology as like a 12-year-old's theology. Do you notice a change while you're out there around the country in the churches that it's maybe switching out of this 12-year-old theology? It seems to be perpetuated year after year. 2 weeks from now, the doors will be busting here or around churches around the world, and they're hearing that same old 12-year-old theology. Not here, Ed, but...
Right. Okay, let me see if I can remember all of that. A quick story. Dom Crossan and I were doing an event together, I don't know if it was 10 years ago when this happened. And during the Q&A, I said, well, there are three things I want to say about that. And I did number one, and I did number two. And then I was like, oh, God, what was the third one? And I stumbled around, and afterwards, Dom said, Marcus, once I turned 60, I stopped saying, there are three things I want to say, and I suggest instead that you say, there's more than one thing to say about that. All right, so let me see how much of this I can remember. Let me begin with the Jesus is Lord thing, and I was struck by the fact that that somehow got connected with not being able to have sex, which is bizarre, but okay. But to do the serious thing here. I think maybe the most important thing to know about interpreting the Bible is contextualize. And the reason I say that is because the word Lord had a very specific use in the first century. So did the word Son of God, phrase Son of God. Lord and Son of God were both titles of the Roman Emperor. So when Paul says, Jesus is Lord, he's saying it in that very specific context of the Roman Emperor as Lord having crucified Jesus. Jesus is Lord, that guy is not. It would be like a German Christian in the 1930s, after Hitler had come to power, wearing a t-shirt, and I'll do it in English, that says, Jesus is my Führer. Now, for somebody to wear a t-shirt today that said, Jesus is my Führer, would be curious. It wouldn't be subversive. And so, Jesus is the Son of God. There already was a Son of God. Jesus is Lord. There already was a Lord. The titles of Caesar even included God from God. And so when I say contextualize, 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 I think we should try to recover the subversive meaning of Jesus is Lord rather than it being kind of a Christian cliche. Okay. And then the other part of your question or comment, I also grew up in a tradition. Well, I'll be very candid with you. I didn't have sex until I got married, which is why I got married at 14. But, you know, and in retrospect, well, at the time, the reason was, that's what I had been taught, on Christian grounds. In retrospect, I know that was a reason. I also suspect I was afraid of it, but that's another issue. I think, as a young man, if I had had sex before I got married at 22, and the relationship hadn't lasted, I think it would have devastated me. That's what I mean when I say I think I was also afraid of it. But the basic point is this. I grew up with a form of Christianity in which even desiring a girl was wrong. You could like them, but to imagine making out with them at all, or what they might look like with a button or two undone? I mean, so I had that too. Yeah. So, and I suspect that's part of, who knows where that comes from. It's part of, I don't know if it's part of patriarchy, or if it's if Christianity for centuries has seen sexuality as not a good thing, you know, and or I don't know, but it was very much part of my upbringing too. And I want to do one more thing. You would think, from the Christian right's preoccupation with issues of sexuality and gender, think of it, abortion, homosexuality, role of women, even contraception for some. You would think that God's primary preoccupation is sex. It's weird, you know. And I think Christianity, I'm not sure. I need to back away from that. Buddhists do not have that problem. I know that. And I'm not sure if Muslims do or not. There's a lot of real separation of men and women, and it's all about, oh, you put them together, what's going to happen? I'm talking about single people now. Okay. I'm going to go to the other question, a two-part question. 200,000 people in Jerusalem at Passover, how many of those might have known who Jesus was? Not very many. And I say that because the public activity of Jesus was pretty brief. According to Matthew, Mark, and Luke, a year. His activity started in spring of one year, and by spring of the next year, he was dead. John stretches it out to 3 years. Hard to know if either one of them is using precise chronology, either one meaning John or the synoptics. So the chances of Jesus having a reputation that had spread widely to another part of the country so that a lot of people would have known who he was, and by who he was, you know, a prophet, whatever, not likely. Now, we shouldn't imagine, though, that he was completely unheard of. There's a reason to think that representatives of the authorities in Jerusalem knew about him even while he was in Galilee, and according to the Gospels, sent some of their representatives to Galilee to check him out. And so, you know, maybe we can imagine several thousand of those pilgrims having heard of this guy, being curious about this guy, some of them being sympathizers, some of them being followers. And then, what was the last part of your question?
Do you notice a change?
Oh, yeah. Do I notice a change in terms of movement beyond 12-year-old theology? Yes. And it's not only me who thinks a change is happening. Diana Butler Bass, who a wonderful author and person, if you don't know of her, you should. She dates the change at the congregational level in a perceptible way to the early 1990s, that we begin to find not just individual Christians who have, done a lot of reading or study or whatever, but the life of congregations beginning to be shaped by this emerging or more progressive way of looking at things. And I've probably been in 300 congregations over the last 15 years for events like this. All of those congregations are thriving enough and interested enough in this way of looking at things to invite me and other people like me to be there with them. And I trust this is not self-serving. I receive many more invitations than I can possibly fit into my schedule. And the same is true of figures like Joan Chittister and Diana Butler Bass and Dom Crossan, and I'm just naming names that many of you might have heard of. So there's a strong appetite out there for a way of looking at Christianity that revitalizes it and makes it compelling and persuasive. It's not so much about making it palatable, but about seeing its power. And that's what I mean by persuasive, compelling, attractive. Okay, I think last word?
Yours.
Mine, okay. I want to share with you maybe the most interesting paragraph I've read in the last year. And it's from near the end of Houston Smith's newest book. Now, many of you know the name Houston Smith. He'll be 94 in May and still alive. Wonderful human being. Privileged to call him a friend and oftentimes a lecture partner. And his new book, which I think is not yet a year old, but that means it came out when he was 93, okay. Near the end, he has a little section. By the way, the name of the book is And Live Rejoicing. And it is just full of joy and gratitude. Okay? Near the end of the book, he has a paragraph about what he calls the two cardinal virtues. And I can't remember if he says of the religious life or of the Christian life. But one or the other, okay, makes no difference for my point. The two cardinal virtues, most important virtues. And he begins by saying, well, you might expect that one of them would be love. But I'm not going to say that. And he says, and one of the reasons is that the word love has become so trivialized in modern English. You know, I love pizza. You know, okay. And you know what I mean by that. It's kind of Hallmark greeting card language, you know, okay. And so he said, so I'm not going to use the word love. And then he names what for him are the two most important virtues. Gratitude and empathy. And empathy, of course, means the same thing as compassion. Compassion has Latin roots. Empathy has Greek roots. And I was really struck by that. Some of it is because the older I get, the more grateful I am. And it's not just being grateful because I've reached 71 without serious problems, but it's experiencing gratitude in the dailiness of life. You know, and most of the hours of my day are marked by gratitude. And as I thought about what he had said, I realized, you know, when you're grateful, it's really hard to be mean. When you're grateful, it's really hard to have a hard heart. And I thought, if we had a country of grateful people, how different this country would be. If we had a church of grateful people, how different the church would be, for that matter. And then compassion or empathy is the other central virtue. I spoke last night about compassion as the central quality of God according to Jesus and much of the Bible, and it's related to the word womb. To be compassionate is to be like a womb, nourishing, life-giving. So anyway, I wanted to share that with you, but then I also want to kind of send you off with a commendation to go and be grateful and go and be compassionate. And the blessings of God, Creator, Christ, and ever-present Spirit be with you this night and evermore. Thank you. Thank you.